If corals are affected by climate change and the effects of agricultural pollution, the first impact should be on their growth rate. So, how has the growth rate changed over the last few decades? When organisms get stressed, the last thing they do is die. Generally speaking, if there's low concentrations of pesticides, they will feel pretty sick and they'll grow more slowly as they're chronically poisoned. Same with the effects of carbon dioxide. If they're stressed, the first effect will be on the growth rates. Fortunately, large massive corals actually record their own growth rates, a little bit like trees, which have tree rings. So every year, a lot of trees lay down a ring, and the thickness of that ring gives an indication of how rapidly the tree is growing. The same applies to large corals, except in the case of corals, they're often, well, sometimes, almost as big as a small house, so they can record their growth rates in their rings over periods of many centuries. We actually have data going back to the 1500s. Now, the nice thing about this is we should be able to see the effect of stress from agricultural pollution or climate change going back in time. Now, the Australian Institute of Marine Science has been measuring coral growth rates since about the 1980s. And in 2009, AIM scientists wrote a paper looking at the growth rates going back many centuries. And what they found was over centuries there was a gentle increase, and then in 1990 there was a precipitate decline in the coral growth rate by 15% in just 15 years. As you can imagine, when this hit the press, it caused a major stir. But I'm happy to say that, in fact, there were serious errors in the way they did these measurements, and that, in fact, that drop at 1990 was caused by a measurement change rather than by a fundamental reduction in the growth rates of coral. Perhaps more seriously, though, AIMS hasn't presented coral growth rates for the average for the whole Great Barrier Reef since 2005. So despite us having data for many centuries, we have no data for the last 18 years. So let's now have a close look at the data, and most importantly, how it was collected. Please like and subscribe. So as mentioned before, AIMS started to measure these growth rates, which were about a centimetre each year, back in the 1980s. But in those days, people weren't worried about climate change. What they were looking at in those days was the effect of river floods. Because it turned out that these bands of coral, if you shine a UV light on them, they actually fluoresce, or they actually glow. And so they were able to tell when there were big floods in North Queensland going back many centuries. So, for example, they were able to determine there were huge drought in the 1800s, which we haven't seen the like of since. Now, it's important to say that this work was not easy. Coral is as hard as concrete, and they had to drill a core into these corals on a scuba, underwater, in many cases for hours on end. But this work stopped in about 1990, and that's very important because that's the time when the actual fall supposedly occurred. It didn't start until 2003, when people started to get very concerned about climate change. But the problem is that instead of coring these massive corals, which they did in the first fieldwork, they started to use a lot of very small corals, and they presumed that the growth rates of small corals was the same as the growth rates of big corals. And that doesn't seem to be the case. Fortunately, there was enough data of big corals, even for the latter period, for us to be able to reanalyze the data. So with Eduardo da Silva and Thomas Stieglitz, we reanalyzed it and determined that there was no reduction after 1990. What AIMS had actually found was that there is this reduction in growth rate. As the corals get bigger, they actually slow down their growth rates. So if you start with these little corals, then inevitably, as they get bigger, you will apparently get a slowing down in growth. Now, this is all very good news, although AIMS got quite upset with us And they don't agree with our reanalysis, which is fair enough. Debate in science is always good. But the problem is this, that we've now gone 18 years and Ames hasn't presented a follow-up. By now, we should be seeing a reduction of about 30% in the coral growth rate from what it was in 1990. And this should be easily resolvable if we take the measurements again. You shouldn't be able to just publish a paper predicting the demise of the coral reefs and then not follow it up with more information. So the challenge is this. Ames will eventually have to update the Great Barrier Reef average data. Now, I'm predicting that the amount of coral or the coral growth rate will be more or less the same. Ames will be predicting that it's fallen off a cliff. Ultimately, this will have to be resolved. But in the meantime, it doesn't look as though there's any particular problem. And it's particularly interesting to look at the period of the 1920s onwards, where both Ames and myself would agree that the growth rate hasn't slowed at all. Now, the 1920s was when agriculture really got going in earnest on the North Queensland coast. And there is no reduction in coral growth rate, no matter how you analyse the data. This essentially means the farmers are not having a serious effect on the Great Barrier Reef, because we should first see it in the reduction in growth rates if they're being chronically poisoned. So, as always, it's all looking very encouraging. Well, thanks for watching. If you want more information, they're in the Plato GBR website below. And also, if you have suggestions for topics you want us to cover in the future, put those in the comments. We read all the comments. Thanks very much.